ass back. I'm sorry about that. I did too.
Finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. I'm finding myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise. All that I need is to be with you. And in the quiet, hear your voice. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place.
Got your Bibles, you can turn to Revelation chapter 21. Revelation chapter 21. The world's very chaotic. Sometimes our lives can be very chaotic too. And sometimes we forget just to be still with God. While you're turning there, you know, 1 John tells us in chapter 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. That's what she's singing about. The Word of God is living, it's alive, and it speaks. And, sometimes I forget to get in His presence. Just be still. I'm always doing and going. And sometimes we feel overwhelmed by the things of the world, all the things we're responsible for. Sort of got lost in His presence a few minutes ago. I need that more than anything. We think we need a lot of other things in the world, but what we really need is just to get in His presence and get along with Him and let the Holy Spirit just work and minister in our lives and our hearts. And that's what we need this morning. It's no different. Yes, ma'am. Yes.
And I was thinking, God, I need to hear from you, Lord. I'm desperate. I need to hear from you. Yeah. I need to feel your spirit in my life right now. I mean, take me back to the day that I was saved to. So when my name was written down in that book of life. But also, I remembered that day. He took me back to when I was 7 years old. Felt it with my heart. I can't quite understand it with my head, but I felt it with my heart. But I tell you what, I also remember that he took away those things. I didn't want to do those bad things anymore. I didn't want to do those things. They weren't appealing to me. They weren't important to me. But you know, when I did go back to it, whenever I would maybe sneak and do something with my sister, or you know, I felt that conviction. And I thank God for that conviction.
Amen.
When you don't feel that anymore, that's a dangerous place to be.
Amen.
That's a scary place to be when you don't feel that conviction.
Yeah.
And I just felt that in my heart all week long.
Yeah. There is certain things we need to remember. We see it in the Old Testament with the children of Israel across the Jordan. They should place 12 stones as a remembrance. To remember what God did. What He did in your life. And to share that, what He did in your life, with your children. And your children, their children share it to their children. But all of it's about what God did. We never should forget what God did in our lives concerning salvation. And we should, on the other hand, we should be able to remember. And we should be able to know this morning that God has saved us.
That's right. Amen.
It's not a maybe so.
Yeah.
You know Jesus and He saved you, or you don't. You know it. Even despite me, I didn't say none of us is perfect. And sometimes we say, well, how can I do that if I'm saved? But you'll remember, God changed your life. There was a change. Miss Rose, I may not be everything I should be. I'm definitely not what I used to be.
Amen.
And all of us should be able to say that this morning.
Right.
If we're born again.
Amen. Hallelujah.
And we've been preaching on heaven. And it goes over, and if you look in verse 27 of the chapter 21, it says this, and there shall be no in no wise enter in it, speaking of heaven, anything that is defileth, neither whatsoever worketh abomination or maketh a lie, but that which is written in the name, Lamb's book of life. We sung about it. We sung a song. You should know your names written in the book of life. Up in heaven. It's with God. You know. That's something you know this morning. My name's written down. Yeah. When we think about reflecting on heaven this morning and think about, we're just looking at really at verse 22 this morning. And I'm going to read it to you. Verse 22 is going to be the main verse of this morning's message. Chapter 21. The whole time I studied this week, I felt like God wanted to do something. I struggled last night, God. I stayed up at 1 o'clock. I was back up at 5 o'clock this morning. I know the scripture, but God wants to do something this morning. And He wants to do something in our lives. I do know that. There's somebody's life in this service God wants to speak to. The scripture says in verse 22 of chapter 21, "And I saw no temple therein, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are the temple of it." Speaking of what we've been talking about, the New Jerusalem coming down out of heaven. We looked at the physical dimensions of it last week. We looked at the width, depth, height, all those things. We said we would view it from the literal, that it is a literal heaven. We shared different theologies about it. And we shared that last week the things that's in this New Jerusalem. But here we find one thing that's not in heaven. There's no temple. Let's stop and pray for a minute. Please. Father, God, you're an awesome God this morning. We need to hear from you. God, I know the Holy Spirit is moving and working in the lives of your people. God, would you please lead, God? We just want to be obedient. God, I pray for whatever the need is in the service this morning. God, I pray, God, that you meet that need. We love you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, many people are going to go to a place of worship this morning. Some to hear music, as we've heard this morning, and sing a song along with, they'll sing along with it, sing a worship song to the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost. We worship this morning, and many people are worshiping all across the world. The act or idea of worship, I think, has confused many people. And I'll share a few things about this as it relates to this scripture. In our world today, there's temples throughout the world still, ain't there? There's temples constructed across the world. Today, Christianity is not the only religion. I'll say we're true, but there is other religions that has temples. The Buddhists have a temple over here on Kersey Valley Road where they go to worship. The idea of a temple is not nothing unusual for us today. Temples have been used as a place of prayer, a place, you know, of meditation. In the Old Testament, it's a place of sacrifice when they came to the temple. In a lot of situations, a lot of religions, it's considered to be a sacred place, a holy place, the temple. Think about the idea of the temple this morning. You can go search a world religion. I sit and read just many different religions that have temples in the world today that practice their religion. The Old Testament, the temple was considered to be a place where God dwelt. And even in secular religions, they still consider the little g gods and temples to be a place for their God. They meet with their God. In the Old Testament, though, we learned about the tabernacle. It was constructed, the tent, and that was the place where God came down and dwelt. So when we think about this morning, this idea of the temple, or a place of where God dwells, 2 Chronicles 2:6 says this, "But who is able to build a house seeing the heaven and the heavens of heavens cannot contain him?" How can we contain God in just a temple? We think about that. Who am I then that I should build him a house save only to burn sacrifices before him? We think about that temple this morning. To build a house and God to be contained in it when the heavens of heavens can't contain our God. Now we're talking about the Creator God that created you and me this morning. He literally spoke, the world came into existence. That's a pretty amazing thought, ain't it? And he's contained in a temple this morning. We think about this idea of heaven here, that there is no temple therein. So we think about this. When we're coming to the house, some people consider this place to be the place we come to worship, right? That's what we consider as Christians, right? Are we limited by our worship to this 1 hour? We're going to go home here about 11:45, John, somewhere around that neighborhood. Amen? We're going to go home around, right? So, but are you limited to just worship here? I think a lot of people, the Christians, think they are limited to just that 1 hour. Or you're limited to worship God only inside the building. Only when you come to the house of prayer. People think, well, I go to a temple to worship and to pray. But are you limited just to do that here? No. And that's what we want to, I was just thinking about those things. For the believer, the child of God that's been born again, you know what the scripture says about the temple? It says this in 1 Corinthians 6:19. What? Know you not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you? Which is in you. You hear the wording there, this temple. The Holy Ghost is in you. God is in the temple. This is the temple of God, which you have of God. You are not your own, for you are bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your bodies and in your spirit, which are God's. They belong to God. This temple here belongs to God. When He gloriously saved me, John, the Holy Spirit abides in this earthly temple right here. So I am not limited to worship by a place or a time. Because you have God with you and in you. He's with you all the time. Praise God. Yes, thank you, Lord. Thank you, God. We're not limited to this place, or we're not limited to this altar. Because this body has been bought with a price. Jesus gave His life, so this body, so that I could be saved. A price was given for you. Why would somebody do that? Because God loves you. Because God thinks that much of you. You were bought with a price. This is the temple of the Holy Ghost. And He said that we should honor God in this temple, right? My. I stopped right there, Brother Mike. And I said, my, preacher. Did I say something this week that didn't honor God? Did I go to some place that didn't honor God this week? Did I look at something that didn't honor God this week? Come on now. Let's be honest with God. This ain't about me, guys. I had to ask myself. I sat down there at my desk in the basement and I said, God, I might need to repent. I need to ask for forgiveness. I said a harsh word to somebody I shouldn't have said this week. I acted a fool out there on the job. I don't know who saw me, but probably somebody saw me. I was in their yard working. This is the temple of the Holy Ghost. We should honor God in this temple. If we're going to understand, if we're going to worship Him, it says in the Scripture that there is no temple, no building, no structure in the new heaven. So, well, how are we going to worship? And that Scripture is very powerful. It says, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are the temple of it. So how does that work, preacher? You know, when we think about worship, we need to understand what it means to worship Him. There's a couple ideas here. What does that worship mean? God is worship is the giving of our entire self. Our thoughts, our emotion, all of it's given to God for His use. It ain't just a place that I come to. There is a place of worship where I just get lost in Him, and boy, I'm just praising Him. I'm thanking Him for my salvation. And all of us need to go to that place where we have hands up, we're honoring Him, and we're just lost in Him. I got lost while I go just thinking about who He was and who He is and what He means to me. You know, you're in a place of that you feel like, well, that's worship. And it is. That's the aspect of worship. And we think about this, of giving of our entire self, our thoughts, our emotions. Everything is focused on Him. And that's worship. All of the life is an act of submission. It's an act of worship. All that you do, all that you say, are services to God. It's not centered on a time or a temple. Neither one of those will limit us. But it's done whenever and wherever we are, because we are the temple of God. We're not limited by a time or a building. And that's where all of us said, I'm sure I had to say, God, I failed you this week. I have not got in a place where I was worshiping you, where I got along with you. And I actually needed to get along with Him. See, I was just running, and I was just fighting, and I was just keeping going, and I was trying to press through, John, when what I needed was His strength, and I was trying to do everything in my own. I needed to get to a place of submission and worship, and my thoughts are focused on Him. My emotions are directed towards Him. And just worship. I don't know, maybe your life is not like that, but mine is. It gets like that. A place of worship. The meaning of the New Testament, the New Testament meaning of worship in the Greek is translated as to fall down before, to bow down before. That's the Greek meaning of the word worship. Is worship just a position? Is worship just a position? You know, the word to bow down before. So what do you think when somebody bows down? They bow down to somebody. They bow down to a king. It shows submission, don't it? You're bowing before them. But is that all? Is that all? Is it just the act? Is it about the position? It's more than just the position of bowing. We come and get on our knees. We bow before God. That does show submission and honor and reverence to Him. But worship is much more than that. The Scripture gives us a good understanding of worship. If you turn over to John chapter 4, we've mentioned this Scripture several times along the way of talking and speaking and sharing messages about heaven. In John chapter 4, we met the Samaritan woman at the well. And we learned that she was very, Samaritans were very despised and hated. She even wondered when Jesus spoke to her, and she said this, "You're a Jew, why would you speak to a Samaritan?" Pretty amazing. She was shocked to meet Jesus at the well. The whole account goes on in chapter 4, it starts in around verse 6, and it actually runs through verse 39. Can anybody worship God? Can anybody worship God? When we think about worship, can anybody worship God? It says in verse 14, it says, "But whosoever drinketh," Jesus speaking to her, "of this water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him." What's in us? The Holy Spirit of God has saved us. The Holy Spirit of God is in us. And it is this. It is a well of water springing up into everlasting life. What a beautiful picture of the Holy Spirit in eternity. Oh my. It's springing up. It's in us. The person that's lost cannot truly worship God. Why? Because they don't know God. Why? Because they don't have this well of living water springing up into eternal life. We see this. And I said this again. You know, we think only the born again can worship God. What does the Holy Spirit do in us? It confirms that we belong to God, don't it? If you don't have the Holy Spirit of God in you, you're not a child of God, are you? That's right. That's scriptural. So we have this Holy Spirit of God in us, which enables us to worship God. But isn't worship here on earth hindered? That's what we're talking about. Worship is hindered by this flesh. is hindered by this world. That's why it's hard for us to worship. But in this place here, we're talking about verse 22 of Revelation. There'll be no hindrance. There'll be no limitations. And I said that of time, place. But also, there'll be no hindrances of the flesh. There'll be no hindrance of the world. We do our best to worship God here, but there's something always hinders me. Sometimes it can be the thoughts that come into my mind. You're sitting here right now. Don't tell me you hadn't been sitting here in this service singing a song at some point in time, and you got to thinking about, well, where are we going to lunch today? I'm sort of hungry. And you're sitting there singing a song of God. Some of y'all, don't look at me like I'm the only one that's done that. Or you're sitting there thinking, it's like, I forgot to. It's hindered. That's hindered. You can't have true worship because the hindrance is here. Some is within me. I deal with the flesh, and I'm hindered here in worship. And think about this. What could any worship be to a God who sees all the impurities of my heart and the contradiction of my thoughts and words? And I'm worshiping Him. See, it's a battle within us, and we see that spiritual battle. We deal with that down here in worship. But in over verse 22, we won't deal with that. But there'll be true worship. You remember I told y'all as we was going through this, talking about heaven, that I couldn't truly love my wife as God would want me to, as He desires for me to, because I'm hindered here by what? Sin. We're hindered here by these things. And as it is for love, I can't love you truly. I'll do my best to love you as I should, but I'll probably disappoint you sometime or another in the way I love you because I'm human. But in verse 22, there'll be no hindrances to the way I love you because we're in heaven. We're in that new Jerusalem. But there'll be no hindrances to my worship of God. You know what I'm talking about. Don't you? Have you never gotten this lost in God? Have you never gotten lost in worship? Just lost in His presence? Because His presence is all around you. That's the way it'll be for eternity in heaven. Heaven should mean something to us. This is the place God has prepared for us. Everybody's looking for something down here through a lot of times through drugs, through alcohol, through sex, to have that feeling. Everybody wants this feeling. They want this feeling. You'll never find that feeling here in this world. You'll look for it in a relationship. And listen, we can have wonderful marriages. And we'll look for that feeling, for somebody to love me like that. We look for that perfect, Ms. Parrish, that perfect spouse. I always think about, when I'm thinking about marriage, I think about you, Mike. I don't know why, because I've heard you tell the story of how you waited for God to send you a man. And He sent Mike into your life. And you young ladies, y'all sit down and talk to Miss Parrish sometime about how God brought them together. And I know they have a great marriage, but I know this. Mike's like me. He's broken. And sometimes we don't love you like we should. We're fathers today. I was thinking about being a father as I studied this week and thinking about this message. We love our kids. But, you know, we disappoint them sometimes. As a dad, we disappoint them sometimes. I had to call Courtney on Friday, and Jonah wanted all of us to go out to eat. Me and her and him. And I got stuck over on a job. I guess they're stuck. It's probably my own choosing. I needed to finish it in my mind. So I had to call and say, I'm not coming. And I was over there by myself. Later to God, you have to convict me about that. To say, you know, I probably disappointed you. In heaven? No. Guys, we won't have to deal with these limitations. What we're talking about, we're talking about a place where there's no temple, but there's no need of the temple. There's no need of going to a place of worship because I'm not limited to a place or time or I'm not limited by this body to worship. Jesus, when we talk about it, Jesus points to this time as he continued to talk with this woman here in John chapter 4. In verse 21, he said this, and Jesus saith unto her, "Woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither worship in this mountain nor in Jerusalem, worship the Father." Jesus saying there's coming a time, that's what he's pointing to, where we're not limited. You won't come to this mountain and worship. You're not going to go to Jerusalem and worship. And what he's saying here, there's coming a time where there'll be no limitation on worship. And that points to verse 22. A time when there's no temple. There's no need of a temple because God and the Lamb, the Holy Ghost, everything is present in this new heaven here. The presence of God is going to be so overwhelming that we've just got a touch of it down here. It's going to be so overwhelming. We may bow down and fall to our knees in worship. I don't know. I've heard all kinds of stuff. For me, I'm probably going to sit there and cry. And I know he wiped away all of her tears at this point, but at some point when I get to heaven, I know I'm going to cry. Because I'm moved by what God done for me down here. I'm thankful I'm not on the street. I'm thankful I don't have to wake up this morning in misery. That's because of salvation. Boy, but there's coming a day when there's no limitation. And we wonder, what does heaven look like? What does worship look like in heaven? What's going on? Revelation 7:15 gives us a look. There's several scriptures I share with you this morning for the sake of time. Therefore, they before the throne of God serve Him day and night in His temple. He that sitteth on the throne shall dwell among them. You say, I thought you said there wasn't no temple there. The temple is the... Go back to verse 22 and think about it in relation to that. There is no temple. I read in Revelation 7:15. All of heaven is God's temple. There's not a temple, a building. All of it is the temple. All of it is God's. Not the building made, he said, not a building made with hands. It's a building made by God. Heaven is a place God has prepared for those that have come to Him in faith, believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. He said, I go to prepare, remember, a place for you. This glorified body, the body that I have now is limited. He says they serve Him night and day in 7:15. We can't do that. We might do it for a few nights. We're talking about Miss Rose's husband. He goes out on calls during the night. And she's saying he had a couple calls last night. He'll get a call. He's got to go out on the road, fix the truck, right? So that's okay. But if that goes on night after night, that man don't get no sleep. He ain't going to make it too far. In heaven, we can worship day and night. That's why I said before, as we studied this, we have to have a body, a glorified body, that's fit for eternity so that me and you can serve Jesus and worship Him day and night all throughout eternity. That's what we'll do. Worship and serve Him in His presence. His presence will engulf you. It'll surround you. And you'll love each one as you should. And that's something we hadn't been able to do. Ezekiel 37:27 gives us this. My tabernacle also shall be with them. Yea, I will be their God, and they shall be my people. What a beautiful picture of heaven. He's going to be with them. All around us. Our scripture today, if you go back to Revelation 21:22. And it says there, the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are the temple. God is present. God is all over heaven. All over heaven, the new earth, this new Jerusalem, all of it's God's temple. What a beautiful picture. His presence is all around us. And that's what he said. There's no need of a physical building because I'm going to be there with you. It's a wonderful thought for us to think about. For us, the Bible tells us, if you remember in the Old Testament, you think about the priest. Well, the priest was the only ones that could go in the Holy of Holies and go in with where his presence were, where God abided. They was the only one. Guess what the Bible calls believers? Revelation 26 says this, they shall be the priest of God. You know he's going to be a priest. That's what it says. It identifies us as a priest. And I'll give you another. Revelation 1:6 says, and he hath made us kings and priests unto God and his Father. To him be the glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. The believer is the priest. We're the ones that abides directly with God in heaven. That's a pretty good picture there of what it's going to be like. Can we worship God now? We talked about limitations. He said this in John 4:23, but the hour cometh now is when the true worshiper shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. When true worshipers, that's what it said in the scripture, when true worship, what does it mean to be true? That means to be real, genuine, not fake. The real worshipers. That's what God, and he's seeking real worshipers to be genuine and true. See, you think, well, mom and dad don't see this. And you think, well, my husband don't see this. My wife don't see this. But it doesn't matter whether your husband, your wife, your mom and dad sees it. God knows your heart. You can't hide from God. You can't hide from him this morning. You can pretend like you're genuine or you're real, but in God's eyes, he sees the heart of every one of us, and he knows whether you're real or not. He's looking for you. I didn't say perfect. I didn't say perfect now, guys. He's looking for a worshiper, somebody that adores him. I adore my wife. I tell her that. And guys, we should tell her wives that. And we should adore her wives. You married her, right? Huh? But to adore God, I get an idea in this relationship what it means to adore. I just want to say, husband and wife, these relationships help you. They do help you. I understand a little bit about what it means to adore, but to adore God. I told you, I can adore him really like he deserves. I can give him my all. I can be a true worshiper in heaven, but can we do it here? We can strive for it. To be a true worshiper, to be real, genuine. To worship God in spirit. And that has nothing to do with posture or position, but it has everything to do with the heart. That's what it's got to do with. To worship God in spirit. Without the Holy Spirit of God, we already said we can't worship God. We got to be saved. We can't not respond to God in worship because we don't really know him. We know him in the scripture here, but not like the Holy Spirit knows him. 1 Corinthians says this in 2:11, for what man knoweth the things of a man? Save the spirit of man, which is in him. But listen to this. Even so, the things of God knoweth no man, but the Spirit of God. We don't know, but the Spirit of God in us is what reveals to us who God is. See, if you don't have the Holy Spirit of God in, He's the one that reveals Scripture. He is the Word. You got to have the Holy Spirit to reveal. And you just look at that. That was 1 Corinthians 2:11. We can worship God now when we're filled with the Holy Spirit of God. 1 John said that, 4:23. We worship Him in spirit and truth. What's true? The Word of God is truth. The Word of God is truth. Truth is the true worshiper. The two go hand in hand. The true worshiper and true. And that means to be the same thing. True, honest, real. That's the true worshiper. What is truth? It's when the one that is worshiping responds to the Word of God that's been preached, to the Word of God you have read, and we respond to it with a repentant attitude. We that say, God, I'm not perfect, but God, I tell you what, I want Him. I'm going to strive to be like Jesus. I'm going to try to be real, try to be genuine. And God, I want to worship You. That's what we should do right now. We respond to Him in that way. Yes, I'm God, I'm sorry for my sins. I'm repenting. I want to turn away from Him. God, I need Your help. God, I'm battling with this sin. Now, you just be honest with Him. We need to get real honest with God. I'm tired of meeting so many perfect people. Everybody I talk to, Mike's perfect. And here I am over here, Miss Judy, I'm struggling. I'm struggling, and I know that I got stuff that I'm struggling with. Well, look, we just need to be honest with God. You can keep pretending to us like you're perfect. You won't get no help here. How can I encourage you if you think you're perfect? I mean, if you come in here all the time and you're Miss Perfect or Mr. Perfect, how can I say, you, Miss Judy, I'm going to pray for you. Just keep on keeping on. Keep on worshiping Him. Keep on reading the Word of God. If she don't let me know, see, we're not real with each other.
Yeah.
We're not genuine. We come in here and put up a front.
Yeah.
You need to be honest. And listen, to the ones you're being honest to, you need to keep the business in the church. You don't need to go out and talk about nobody. If somebody gets real honest, it's for the family. You know, there's things Miss Paris, me and the boys sit about and talk to Miss Courtney. And you know what I tell them? This is family business. They know what that means. It don't go outside these four doors. That's not that I got secrets from y'all or anything like that. There's some business don't need to be aired out. We help each other in our family unit. They be honest, if he's honest with me, if Isaiah's honest with me, and I'm honest with him, we can help each other.
Amen.
But if we ain't going to be real and genuine, that's going to be real hard.
Amen.
When we come to the house of God here, we got to be true, honest. But listen, because this is something in heaven, there's going to be no limitations. I know we're not going to be dealing with this, but we're dealing with it now. We're dealing with sin. We're dealing with brokenness. I know in 22, we ain't going to have to deal with all of it. We ain't got there yet. We're still down here trying to tell somebody about Jesus and share the gospel. We're struggling. We need to quit beating each other down. I'll say it again here in the house of God. We studied this in Acts, didn't we, Brother John? How many times we're in the 15th chapter of Acts, and I found Paul and Barnabas, what are they doing? Encouraging somebody in the faith. Encouraging somebody. Tell them about their sin. Tell them they need to be saved. That's fine. Need to repent. But at the same time, boy, you keep on getting on. Boy, you keep on telling about Jesus. Encouraging people in the faith. I didn't find them beating them down. I didn't find them going out there and talking about them either. So we got to keep. They ain't none of that going to be in heaven. Don't you think we need to practice it here? True. Worship requires a mind centered on God and renewed by the truth of God, His Word. It requires it. If you don't ever come to church, if you don't ever come to church and hear the Word of God, if you don't ever go to the D crew and listen to them teach over, Mike and them were so excited about what they was teaching Wednesday night. Man, if somebody's excited about teaching, you ought to be here to support that. You need to hear that truth spoken into your life. Maybe you don't even open up the Bible. For 7 days, you don't open up the Bible, but you come here on Sunday and hear it. You come here on Wednesday and you hear the Word of God. I need it. I listen to preaching because I need to be preached to. I need somebody to preach to me beside my wife. You know what I'm saying?
Amen.
I don't know how much of that is the Word of God, Mike, but it's preaching. I need somebody, a man of God, to preach to me. I listen to preaching. Why? Because I got problems. I'm trying to get in line with what God wants me to do. So finish up here. And you know, he said God is seeking true worshipers. That means God desires you. That means He wants you to be a true worshiper. He wants us to be honest and genuine and true and come. And if we need to be saved, say, I need to be saved. I want to be a true worshiper of You, God. I believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. I want to be saved. But if you're here this morning, God has brought you to a place where, look, there ain't nobody in here knows you ain't genuine or real, but God knows. And listen, you may be a believer. Maybe you're battling with something. A sin that it's been hard to release it. It could be a boyfriend or girlfriend. And it's causing you to fall back into the same sin trap. for a husband or wife, it may be that relationship outside that marriage, that person at work. I don't know. But God does. I don't have to know. But God knows your heart. In this place, there'll be no temple. We'll be surrounded by His presence. God's looking for a pure heart, open and repentant. Are you real this morning? Are you real? Stand with me. I said, Mom and Dad may not know, but God does.